Hello everyone, it's the Welfarery. That was Know Your Rights by The Clash. Just wanted to say to everybody, this is the first time I've ever done anything like this. I haven't given it much thought, so I'm just going to speak. Okay, I'm doing this because I was made redundant in October. I've done advice work most of my life. I'll just give you a very quick, I don't want to bore you, but I'll give you a really quick rundown as to sort of my sort of past. I started working for what was now, it's now the DWP, it was then the DHSS. Did the old supplementary benefit. I don't know if any of you remember that, if you're that old, but some of you might, I certainly do. So I did that, and then I did the income support and all the other, you know, the new JSA training. Sorry, the mic's gone. So I did all that, and then I just couldn't bear being there anymore. It was a nightmare. It was really awful. So I left, and I've done advice work ever since. So I've done housing advice. I've done back to work advice. I've done benefits advice. It's the thing I really enjoy doing. I've worked with really difficult people, but it's something I really enjoy doing. And for me, I'm doing this now because it's just got to the point where everything is becoming so overloaded. People are becoming so overloaded with everything. I spent most of today with somebody that lost their job around the same time as me, signed on, got a letter stating that he wasn't entitled to Job Seekers Allowance contribution based. I'll talk about that a bit later, but basically he was told that he wasn't entitled to any money when he actually was. So this man has had no money since October. I went with him today, filled out a form, and he'll get paid now. But that man was having a really, really difficult time. So it's the changes that are going to be coming are going to be really, really harsh, and I don't think people are really prepared for it. I'm going to talk about stuff today. The stuff that I was going to talk about were the changes. And really, what would be good is if people can post stuff in the chat box that they want to talk about. And I was going to talk about the mandatory work programme today, getting back stuff like your bank charges, using the social fund before it goes. I don't know how many people are even that up to date with what's going on in benefits, because it's such a massive thing. And what seems to happen is, I don't know, just people just seem to forget that it's even going on. It happens, and no one seems to care until it's too late. But I suppose that's the way with everything. Okay, well, I'm going to... is there anything that anyone particularly wants to talk about? Otherwise, I'll just scroll through my notes. Yeah, hold on. Okay, hold on. My notes have just disappeared. Hold on. Right, the work programme. Is it mandatory? Yes, it bloody well is. I keep seeing people saying it's not mandatory. You can write a letter, you do this, do that. Go the Freeman route if you want to, but it really isn't going to win you anything. If you want to play them at their own game. Know the regs and know what you're talking about. Play them at their own game. Fight them that way. You're not going to win any other way. You can send them a letter and not contract and all that kind of stuff, but you're not going to win. You really aren't. There's the work programme, which is mandatory. There's also the work experience programme, which is very different. Now, you can get out of that. I'll post a couple of links in a sec. Hold on. Right, well, the work experience is for people aged 16 to 24 who are claiming job seekers. Right, basically, if you want to get out of that and you really don't want to do it, then you've got a week's cooling off period. You do not have that with the work programme. It's mandatory, you have to go. It's a 4-week programme. The only way you can get out of doing that work programme is looking up the good cause clause. Sorry, bit of a
tongue twister.
Yeah, a bit of a tongue twister there. Hold on. Alright, okay. Good cause, I mean, it's defined in many, many ways, and that's why it's really difficult. I mean, the main ones are your health, exceptional pressure to your family. I'll post a link, and I don't know if that should probably be helpful, because if you do want to get out of doing this, and I don't know, I'm sort of mixed about the work programme. I don't think you should be made to do anything, and the stuff that I hear about it isn't good. I know a couple of people that have been put in charity shops and aren't getting any training, you know, they're not going to get a job at the end of the 4 weeks. I do see people's point when they say, I don't know. It's difficult. It's a difficult one. Sorry, I'm just scrolling down my notes. The other real biggie that's come up this week is bank charges. There's a, basically, if you're on any benefits, most benefits, tax credits, JSA income support, you can get your bank charges back. It's really, really easy. All you have to do is write a letter, and you have to use Section 187 of the Social Security Administration Act 1982. I'll post all this in the chat box, but I can't do two things at once. I'm not a great multitasker. So I'll probably put on a song in a minute and see what you guys are thinking in the chat box and get back to you. Right, look, I'll do that. Do you want to stick on a tune for us?
Okay, yes.
Hate is your enemy. Love has practically caused me to get you destroyed. If I had hated a little more, just a little more, we would have had a little less trouble. If I look at my thoughts differently, sure, you got love. Principle! But don't say, hate is my enemy. What do they say? What's that word? Hate is my enemy. I gotta fight it day and night. One of the others is the line. Love's the only weapon. Shit!
There will now follow a short announcement on behalf of the First Presbyterian Church of Elvis the Divine, UK.
Shoot me!
Yo, 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 so how many twins do you want?
Shoot me!
Hello everybody again. Right, I'm just looking in the chat box and the machine's asking, God, yeah, the JSA and the constant threat people are under to find work. And the hoops they make you go through, and having your benefits stopped, sanctioned. I mean, it's harsh, and it's getting harsher and harsher, and the changes will be even worse when they do come in.
Doesn't that also dial into the issue that we were just talking about with the targets?
Yeah, I mean, there's an article, and I'll post a link to that article. I think it was in the Guardian about targets and benefits agency DWP and the targets that they apparently have to meet, which they denied. Obviously, they have got targets. They are trying to get people off any benefit. That's why there are so many changes, and the changes are massive for every benefit. The changes are huge. I really don't know what people will do. The few people that I've been talking to recently that are having issues, it's harsh enough now. I just worry with everything that's happened, the cuts, everything that's happened around this, how people would manage with frontline services cut. Mine was a frontline service. I worked for a local authority, and we went, all of us have gone, there's nobody left there. Sorry, I was just reading something, sorry. Yeah, I lost my job in October. I signed on. I have to go, since I think I've been signing on 19 weeks, and I've had to go every single week. 17 weeks out of 19, I've had to go every single week. A personal advisor sits and talks to me. I'm searching for a job. They keep offering me, pulling up jobs for like 16 grand, 20 grand, which, you know, that's really not for me. Not at this point in my life. It's really not for me. If it was, it's
well,
just
to explain, that would be a hundred. Well, it would be a 50% of your previous wage.
Yeah, and you can look for jobs for six months at the salary, or 3 months at the salary you were earning before. Then they start pressuring you, and the pressure is really great. I just find it incredible. Even going to the job centre, I went with this guy today to Woolwich Job Centre. His appointment to sign on was at 11:30 this morning. We arrived at about 11:10, so I tried to get out of the car. He told me, no point in getting out of the car. They won't let you in till 5 minutes before. So I looked at him, I thought that's a bit strange. So I signed on at Peckham. There's loads of security guards on the door, but you show them your card and they just let you in. We had to wait outside till 11:25, then go in. They wouldn't let me in. I had to go back to the reception, get a little slip that was filled in, so I could actually go upstairs with him to sign on. It's just incredible. This guy has been He's had no money whatsoever since October. I can't imagine trying to, living on nothing, absolutely nothing. And what a state that, the pressure that puts you under. Just incredible. I don't know. Right, hold on, let me have a look at some of the stuff that you guys are talking about. Hold on.
I was going to say, Neil Machine just brought up there about the call centres being so appalling.
Well,
and that's a point there that I just put in the chat box. That's really where you've come in. That you can't get your questions answered through their call centres. So this is where you come in with your new Skype room.
Yeah, I've set up a Skype room. It's I think it's a welfare rights room.
Yeah, it's the welfare rights group.
Yeah, so I've set that up, and we're setting up a website. I've bought the domain name, so I'm going to start setting up. So anything that goes out here, there'll be templates on the web page. There'll be all the links, all the info. So I will get that together. I've not been very well this week, and my son's come back from uni as well, so it's been a bit chaos. But yeah, I will get that together. Hold on. Yeah, welfare, we can surely take calls.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that'd be really nice. No, that'd be great.
Okay, well, anybody that's...
I'm not too keen on talking to myself.
anybody that's got me as a Skype contact is welcome to call in, then. We've got Skype open here, and certainly you'd be heard in the room, so...
Okay, yeah, next week, that's fine. That would actually be loads better, because it's... I don't really know what you want me to talk about. I mean, I can... Actually, the one thing I did want to talk about that really got my goat last week was seeing Ivan. Actually, is he here?
No.
Well, it's a shame, really, because I've got a few issues with him, really.
Now.
Well, I have. I mean, some of the stuff that he was saying, really, if you really don't know what you're talking about, don't talk about it. I don't know about Freeman stuff, so I don't talk about it. I know stuff about welfare rights, so therefore I'll talk about it. He clearly doesn't know very much, so I've been doing this probably for about, most of my life, most of my adult life. I'll put up a link for the Skype room, Jack.
Oh, yeah.
yeah, I've been doing this for most of my life, and I would say... 98% of the people that I've seen are genuine. You're always going to get people that are trying to blag or, get what they, what they're not entitled to. You're always going to get it. But most people are genuine, and they are in genuine need. It's not... Yeah, I mean, also, I know that it's sort of bandied about in the Daily Mail, people sitting on their backsides all day watching Jeremy Carr. And no, that's not particularly fruitful to you. To your life, is it? But it's just incredible the bad press that even people with disabilities are getting. It's just, just shaft everybody, be horrible about everybody, just bitch about everybody, nobody needs anybody, it's just awful, just horrible. Anyway.
Data protection people are asking about in the chat.
Okay, why have I not mentioned the Data Protection Act? Well, why would I mention the Data Protection Act? If you want me to talk about Data Protection Act, I will, but why in particular? Why are you asking, why have I not mentioned it? I will mention it if you want. How do you want me to mention it?
I think Blue Sky's mentioned something earlier about the...
Oh, sorry, apologies, I wasn't looking.
The workfare thing being a breach of Data Protection Act.
Oh, sorry, I missed that.
Possibly the only approach that you could take to avoid.
Hold on. I prefer the easiest route. What, you want me to sign the Data Protection Act? Okay, you don't have to sign the Data Protection Act, but it's still mandatory. You still have to sign on, don't you? So, yeah, I mean, there are things... Yeah, don't sign the Data Protection Act if you don't want to. There are forms that you don't have to have your CV on, on their files. You don't have to have any. You don't have to do any of that. It's not the only protection you have against workfare. As I'm saying, if you're going to win this game, you need to play them at their game. And this is what I'm trying to do. You need to know the regs and fight them at their game. There is, for everything that you claim or that you want to claim or that you think you could claim... there will be a reg out there that will be able to work your way around it, and there really will be.
Again, there's I think it may need a little clarification here, that there is a situation here where we have a large proportion of this movement may well be equipped with the wherewithal to deal with the system and to confront it on a legal or lawful basis.
Yeah.
But the likes of the chap that you were helping today is more or less illiterate.
Yeah.
And he received a simple letter from the Dole office which had left him impoverished and with no income since October, which is, you know, I mean,
poor.
Regardless of all of the various get out clauses and all of the rest of it, really, the essence of this is not to project some sort of sovereign movement aspect of this, but just simply to help people who are in this situation and who are having to deal with this within the system, because a lot of people just aren't ready to step outside of that system yet.
No, I agree.
They don't have the equipment.
Yeah, and Jeff's said something really good as well. Most people that actually need the help never actually get it, because they're the people that usually don't ask, and so they don't know. If you've got no prior knowledge of benefits, or if you've never claimed, and most people go, well, you know, they're working life and don't claim, lose their job, and then, you know, stuck in this situation where, excuse me a sec, stuck in this situation where they have to make a claim for something they have no idea about. So it's a difficult one. Yeah. Hold on. I don't know I don't actually agree with what you're saying there, Blue Sky. They can pimp. Well, they can't pimp you out, but they can sanction you. And if you get sanctioned, you're sanctioned for 13 weeks, 3 months, then 26 weeks, 6 months. It's an awfully long time to have no money. Do you understand what I mean?
I mean, the other situation here is that what another issue here is that many people that are trying to find ways around the welfare system aren't necessarily, like you say, those most in need. Some of the people that you deal with, the Allens of this world, where you have an elderly couple with a disabled child and just mountains of problems and history, and they're not equipped.
No, they're not equipped at all.
They're not equipped to deal with the state generally, let alone the bloody welfare state and all of its control structures. So, you know, I mean, this is really this isn't a platform to debate the rights and wrongs of the welfare state.
No, it's not. And also, yeah, I know you've done nothing to deserve sanctioning, and the signing of that is not mandatory, but getting your... when you go and sign in, you're signing on saying you're available for work and you've signed the Job Seekers Agreement. Your Job Seekers Agreement is probably the most important thing that you're going to ever sign when you go to the Dole office. Make sure that everything in that Job Seekers Agreement is in there that you need. So if you've got, I don't know, I've got, we've got a son that's got some disability. So it's in my Job Seekers Agreement that I might have to leave suddenly to go and, you know, go and take care of him. So make sure that, I mean, there are loads of things you can use. You can, you know, if you have to do something, then make sure it's in your Job Seekers Agreement right from the very start. And that way you've got that always to fall back on. It's knowing really what you can do and what you can't do, and most people don't know. So hopefully, you know, in a few weeks' time, you might be a little wiser than you are now. I'm not a fountain of knowledge. I'm not, you know, Miss Wonderful, Mrs. Wonderful. I'm not Mrs. But I will do my very best to help whoever gets in touch with me. If they need any personal help, then that's fine. I'm more than happy to do it. And well, hopefully...
not to blow your own trumpet too much, but even in the less than a week since you... set on this particular thing, obviously we were getting, you know, I mean, we're already still helping people, but just the people that have come to you through the Skype room and the various connections that we've got with TPUC and the like, you've probably already saved a few members of this community several thousands of pounds. one way or another. If what?
Well, I hope so.
If they're able to apply all of the various strategies that you've given them to deal with their problems, we're talking about a significant sum of money.
Yeah.
In a very few days. Now, yeah. If you extrapolate that out to our entire community, and bearing in mind that's 3 days' work, so if you extrapolate that up to a year's work, think of how many thousands of government pounds that should be in this community that aren't in this community because of people's inability to claim within their system.
Well, when I was working, it was I'd have sessions booked. I'd have like a 2 hour session in one building and another 2 hour session in another building, so I'd have to drive from one to the other. And it would be, as soon as you put up a sign, benefits of free benefits advice, it would just be chock-a-block. And at that point, I was doing advice work for vulnerable families. So all the people that I saw were in genuine need. As I say, you're always going to get the odd one, but 98% are genuine, and they really are. Hold on, let me just have a quick read. There's something about, hold on, the agreement does state that could be negotiated at any time by... Yeah, it can be, but it's easier to do it at the time. Obviously, if you're going back to them, if you turn up and something's come up and you know this is going to be coming up, or you need a reason to be able to do what you need to do, just make sure it's in your job seeker's agreement. If you need to change it down the line, then change it down the line. It's just easier to do it at the start because it seems like it's like a bit of an excuse, and it's better for you if you do it right at the beginning. Hold on, as a knock-on effect with regards to other benefits. Yeah, well, again, it's supposed to be, well, now it's much easier. As soon as you sign on, I mean, you're supposed to ring up your housing department and make your claim immediately. And if you don't, then it's going to make it really difficult for you. It's people not knowing what they're entitled to. Right, I've really got to go and get a drink, so... Well, I'm just going to stick on a quick tune.
Yep. A bit of dub effects. And there you go. bring him into the cooler. Neon. We can.
Hello. Thank you for ringing.
That's all right.
How's it going?
Oh, that's okay. No, it's not going usually.
So what's your sort of experience with the doll then?
Experience. Well, the thing is, it's on both sides. It's fine. So I used to work with the doll years ago.
Okay, what were you doing?
Well, there was nothing particularly. There wasn't any height of level, it was a low level administration. But, so I kind of saw, like, within, you know, the system and side the system.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's hearing what everyone's got to say, really. You can, well, just talking, we're going to be able to help people today.
I mean, it's like, I've been, as an example, just had to repeat playing JSA up to 4th week. And it's still on tape. I had to get it down today and cause a bit of trouble, really. Because, you know, you haven't even paid in 4 weeks, you know?
Why are they taking so? Why have they taken 4 weeks and not to pay you? What are they saying?
they don't answer. I said, why is it taking so long? I don't have the information to tell you that, sir.
You're kidding. That's what they're telling you.
Oh, yeah, so this is in the call centre. The thing is that on the front lines in the job centre, it's like they don't really know much of anything. They will just pass you on to the call centre. Whatever benefit it is, they'll just say, use the phones.
Yeah.
So, you go and use the phones, you push a little button, you'll be sitting there waiting, you know, for how long it takes for you to get through. You know, push this button to get to JSA, push this button for income support, in cab and all that sort of stuff. But I'm talking to this guy, and he sounds like a young chap, and he doesn't really... I mean, you ask them questions, and they it's almost as if they're just trying to avoid giving you an answer. They just don't know. I don't know if they even know deliberately.
Yeah, I'm not sure. It's, you know, sometimes it's genuine.
I think it's their training. They really just don't know. They just read scripts. It's just a script.
Well, I know when I was working for, you know, the DHSS, we had to do training. I don't know how you could have done it without having training. You had to know what you were doing.
I think I remember when I worked there and they used to give you, I think it was 3 months. Oh, that's not a good sound. I've got to go. Oh, that's just typical.
You all right?
Yeah, I've got to go now. I've got to go and eat.
Lovely to talk to you.
Can I call back in 10 minutes?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Blinded.
Okay, I'll call back. Sorry about that.
No worries.
We've just got the level sorted, so you'll be able to tip it back in properly.
Cool.
Okay, well, you can be talking about what his problems are there while you're waiting.
Well, most of these people aren't trained, they don't know, they don't get paid very well either. To do the job that they do, they don't get paid very well. Most of those frontline staff are only on about 22 grand a year. It's not a great deal for the shit that you have to go through doing that job every day. It really isn't a lot of money. I know I wouldn't do it for that money, absolutely no way. You wouldn't pay me that, I'd do that, no way. Anyway, that's besides the point, but it's, yeah, they're not trained, and they lie to you. They really do, they lie to you. They'll tell you whatever they want, as long as it's to get you off the phone, as quick as possible. They'll just tell you lies. As an advice worker, you can act as an intermediary for a client. All you need is either written or verbal authority. If it's verbal, your client has to be with you. If your client isn't with you, it's got to be facts, they have to have it in writing. They will accept a fax generally, sometimes they won't, but most of the time they will. But you can act as an intermediary for somebody. I was working with somebody last week that was dealing with tax credits office, and they were told that I was not allowed to act on their behalf. And they believed them, they absolutely believed them. So in the end, we actually drove an awfully long way to help out somebody that had been completely lied to. Just absolutely unbelievable. But what do you do? I mean, we've just all got to get together and learn how to fight them at their game, because that's the only way we're going to win. We have to fight them at their game. Hold on.
I think I just deafened half the audience.
Oh, right, I think Jack's deafening everybody.
My humble apologies. apologies to anybody whose eardrums are now bleeding. I found the right button in the end, though.
The other thing that I wanted to talk about today was what's going to happen to the social fund. I mean, I don't know how many people have accessed the social fund, you know, but the social fund's supposed to be there as a fallback, you know, if you can't get any money. For instance, Neon Machine hasn't had any money for 4 weeks. He should be able to get a crisis loan. He should be paid today. He should be given some money, but he clearly wasn't, and nobody told him that he should be applying for a crisis loan. He'll have to pay that money back out of his benefit. He'll have to sign something that says he'll pay that back. But fine, at least give the band some bloody money. Christ. I don't know. Anyway, it's the other stuff that's happening with the social fund. Most of it's all being outsourced to local authority, and local authorities have already said that they do not have a new duty to provide a social fund, and they are definitely not going to provide a community care grant. And I don't know if anyone knows what a community care grant is, but it's a grant, not a loan. Most social fund payments are loans, so you've got a budgeting loan. Normally, you get a budgeting loan. They always offer you a budgeting loan. They never offer you a community care grant because it's a grant. You don't have to pay it back. Most people are entitled to a community care grant once a year. That can be anything from like 500 quid to 2 grand. You know, it's dependent on their budget for the year. I would say to anybody that's struggling, I'll put up the link for a community care grant, because it's the one thing that anyone that's claiming a benefit should be able to get if they're struggling. And if possible, don't go the crisis loan route if you can. If you need money quick, if you've got nothing to survive on, go the crisis loan route at the moment, because you've got that option. Next April, you won't have that option. And this is what really, really worries me. Either people don't care, or they don't notice what's actually happening to the benefit system around them. It's the changes that are going to be coming are going to be phenomenal. They're going to be really, really harsh. If you think things are harsh now, I mean, at the moment, you can get disability living allowance if you've got a disability. You have to satisfy a care component and a mobility component. It's hard enough as it is. I was reading about somebody today that it might have been a post on TPUC, actually. Yeah, it was. And this post was about... it was about claiming DLA. Somebody who had multiple cancers had claimed DLA, had been refused, had only got DLA when they, you know, were bawling their eyes out on the phone to, you know, asking why they'd been refused, were awarded DLA for a year. Having multiple cancers, having to fight for something that you should get with no problem, why should you be hassled about something when you've got cancer? This actually happened to friends of ours that had a daughter with cancer of the kidney. It was really, really horrible. She was six at the time, and her mum found a lump on her kidney. She had to have chemo. She was really sick. They didn't want to give her DLA. They didn't want to pay her. They only paid her when her mum was sobbing and sobbing, you know, crying and breaking her heart. I mean, lucky she got it breaking her heart. Normally they just hang the phone up on you. But, you know, maybe the word cancer makes them feel really bad or something. But, sorry, that's probably a bit mean, but that's just how I feel about how nasty and cruel they are. But if you think DLA is difficult, wait till PIP comes in. DLA's changed to personal independent payments. And everyone on DLA now will have to have a new face-to-face assessment to get DLA. It's like having to fight for something which should be genuinely yours. It's worrying.
We've got Neon back.
Oh, hello. Back. Yeah, do.
Righto. One sec.
Okay, you must eat fast. Wolf that down.
Oh, yeah.
Hello, did you wolf that down then?
Yeah, it was quick. It was just a slight salad.
It must have been. Blimey.
Yeah.
Anyway,
nowadays. But anyway, where were we?
Sorry, yeah, about I was that. Actually just saying, did they not offer you a crisis loan?
No.
Right, now, why not? See, they should have done. If you've got no money and you're entitled to some money because you are destitute and you need money, and they have a system in place as a backup when you don't get paid, why aren't they offering you that? It's pretty poor. It's a pretty poor service.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember now, because they keep changing so much. Because I mean, I still know people who basically work there, and you know, I have conversations with them. I keep in touch with them, and they kind of tell me some of the changes that are going on. But I'm, for me to remember and be specific, but
yeah, you know,
it's quite a while ago. But you know, things just—they do just keep changing things. They're cutting things back, or they're moving things around. You know, it's kind of this. It's kind of as if a lot of things that still exist, but they. It's like, from my experience, they've kind of always been like this. They won't really tell you. It's kind of.
Yeah, we're expected to know, aren't you?
You're expected to know, or you're expected to find out. It's almost as if they want to. They say it's your responsibility, but they're not really providing you a service if that's the only attitude they have.
And that's just very quickly. That's why I posted that good cause clause up, because that good cause clause you can use not just for the mandatory work program, but you can use that for anything really. With any benefit, if you feel that you're not, if you've, you know, they've told you you've applied late or that you didn't know, use that clause, use that reg. Go on, carry on, sorry.
So, I mean, it's interesting. I mean, when I first applied, I mean, I said to them, because I never liked the idea of any payment going through the bank system, to be honest.
Well, it just makes it easier for them to administer, doesn't it?
Well, yeah, I suppose, yeah.
It's not for your benefit, is it? It's not for our benefit, it's for theirs.
No, of course it is, yeah. Because, I mean, how could it be for my benefit if it's taking 3 to 4 weeks to get paid? It can't be for my benefit at all, can it?
Well, right. No.
So, I mean, initially I said, they didn't even mention gyros. I said, well, can you pay me by gyro, please? Oh, I can't do that.
Oh, gyro? I don't know anyone that's had a gyro for a long, long time. Do you know anyone that's had a gyro?
Who, me?
Yeah.
No.
Anybody? No. Just post in the chat box if anyone knows anyone that's had a gyro recently.
But this is the interesting thing, because the lady on the phone at the time, they basically just admitted and just said, because I kept on mentioning, gyro would be better. She said, well, it's not really, because gyros will not exist come April.
So no gyros whatsoever. I mean, they must be very few and far between as it is.
Yeah, I mean, I remember, I mean, they closed down, I mean, every benefit or every department or, you know, job centre, because they're all based in main buildings, and they have small department sections within the main building.
Yeah.
It's not just the frontline job centre that people recognise.
I think they're planning on changing over to a new electronic...
Well, yeah, I mean, it seems like they're just trying to port everything over to electronic, even.
Well, one would have to wonder, would a gyro not in fact be true legal tender rather than a fiat transfer?
Yeah.
If you want to talk about it in that terms.
But this is the thing, I mean, when I went in there today, Jack and Ferry, you know, I said, like, it's an emergency. You haven't paid me. And when I use the word emergency, they kind of changed their tune slightly.
Yeah.
Then they decided, oh, we can pay you in a gyro check.
A gyro check?
Yes.
Oh.
I said, well, he gives you two choices. He says, well, we can pay you in a gyro check or for the banking system. And I said, well, it's already been set up in the banking system. It's taken 4 weeks. And he said, well, you know, we can do it as a gyro check. And I said, well, which one's going to be fastest? And he was basically like saying, well, he wasn't too sure. It's almost as if he was just going by what's on the screen or what's in front of him. But it's kind of like along the lines of, you know, well, you know, we have to get this guy to do this, and then we have to get permission to do this, and blah, 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 and maybe you'll get it tomorrow. So, okay, so what about for the bank? Oh, it's more than likely you'll get that tomorrow. So I thought, so there is no quick way then. No, not really.
Really unhelpful. Really, really unhelpful. Just unbelievably unhelpful.
You're basically saying, look, I mean, it's almost as if you see, it's like, look, there's a guy, and he's got a knife to my throat, and I need to get paid now. Oh, we can't do that.
Yeah.
You know, it's just like that situation, you know? It's an emergency. I'd like to help this.
I just think as well that all of them, I think, and I know how easy it becomes. I know that when I don't know if you, because I know you did an admin job. When I worked for the DHSS, you had to do like a stint in each section. So like you do a bit in fraud, then you do a bit in, you know, finance, and you do a bit in, you know, another section, then you do a bit in, you know, your own section. So you'd have a bit of, you know, you'd have a bit of knowledge all over the place. But it doesn't seem that it, well, as we said earlier, they don't seem to be training anybody anymore for anything. So nobody seems to know what they're doing. And the, I don't know, the kind of attitude they've all got, it's either their right job's worth, and it's like it's their own personal money that they're giving you out of their own pocket, and they treat you like shite, or they genuinely are in this sort of space cadet, I don't know, glazed eyes, I don't know, I don't kind of care because I can't really take it much more kind of attitude.
Yeah. How long ago did you do this?
Oh, God, I mean, that? I was 21, so, over 20 years ago.
Okay, well, I mean, when I was there, and this was like five, six years ago when I was there. I worked there for about 5 years. I was there since, I don't know, since 99, something like that, when I first got a job there. And I used to work at the social fund.
Ooh.
And the social fund, well, I mean, if you want to know...
I do, share.
If you want to know how destitute people are...
Oh, I know, I know.
And I'm not saying that you don't. I'm just saying that anybody wants to know. Social fund is the place to be. Because, I mean, people put in grant forms, crisis loan forms, budgeting loan forms, this kind of stuff, and some of the stories are heartbreaking.
I can't imagine how horrendous it must be to be based in a social fund department for your entire working career. Can you imagine hearing those stories every day? I don't. Would you become numb to it all? I don't know.
When you first start there, you can't really believe it. You can't take it in because you can't believe that you're living in a terrible, free Western democracy and all this bullshit nonsense, and that people are living like this. And you know, it almost looks third world.
Yeah.
You can't believe it. You can't believe it. But the problem is,
because people are that destitute.
Yeah, I mean the problem is because you're working in an environment where people around you, all the other employees and staff, have already accepted it as normal.
Yeah, that's absolutely right, that it's accepted as normal.
It all rubs off on you.
Yeah.
You become sucked into it. So you eventually kind of sort of lose part of your soul. So, but the thing is that, I mean, I've been carrying this, I'm glad you're on, to be honest, Ferry, because I've been carrying a lot of shit on my chest for a long time, and, I just feel like I need to get it out.
Good, we'll share, good.
About this, about working there, and I just know from people who basically make claims, when they apply for these things, because like grants and some kind of loan, because they're in bad situations, they get turned down, and they a lot of them I found get turned down pretty quickly, because obviously the people who are making the decisions, they're just following what they always like to say, rules and regulations.
Yeah.
Right? So they don't really make any responsible decision whatsoever. Because obviously, because we're in a city, it's like being in the military where basically, you're given an order and you say, that's not my responsibility, I'll be given an order, so I just do what. Right? It's exactly the same attitude. The whole thing just seems militant to me.
Right.
So,
Neil, can I just wind you in there? We're up against the buffers time-wise. I'm going to keep you on line after we come off air, because I think you and our fairy here need a chat, don't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, it'd be nice to have a chat. I just want to apologise for talking so fast and being a bit spacey today.
It's the first show, so I wouldn't apologise too badly.
Oh, I think I should.
Neon, do you want to just either mute out or hang up, and we'll call you straight back after we've just played out and given the MOs over to Nick and... is Dr. Rock Show.
Okay, mate, yeah, no problem.
Alright, okay, I'll just mute out if you want, we'll keep you on the call.
Oh, just mute me out, okay.
Okay, alright, mate. Right, okay, love, I think you just need to give out your welfare-y Skype.
I'll do that in a minute, as I say, I can't multitask.
Okay,
speak, drink, smoke.
Right.
Right, well, I will see you all next week. I'll put a link up for the Skype room, and if anyone wants to get in touch, go for it. And I'll be a bit more organised, a bit less spacey
your
next
Skype
week.
Name?
Oh, my Skype name will be useful. It's, well, fairy. Yes.
There you go. Same as the TNS login. And, of course, anyone can PM you on TNS.
Yeah, of course.
And, of course, anyone that's got me as a Skype contact, feel free to use that. Or you can also find, if you go to the top of the TNS page, you will find call-in live. If you go to freemanjack on the call-in live button there, you will be able to call my Skype live. Although I think you may need to add me as a contact first, I don't know. Okay, we're playing out with one of your tunes, love, Faithless, God is a DJ.
Excellent.
And we'll see you all next week.
Yeah, see you next week. Thanks. Thank you for listening.
Okay, good night, folks.
This is my church. This is where I heal my hurts.